So, as you know, the focus of today's event is identity in data. Researchers are expanding their focus on exploring how discourses of self and identity in data remain inclusive from the perspectives of those populations, communities, and individuals. Data collection methodologies are also developing. These methodologies are increasingly becoming perceived as significant and impactful research assets in their own right. And these developments are in themselves a critical element of the social construction of statistics. They reflect, sometimes imperfectly, the lived experience of data subjects. Shortly, we'll be hearing from researchers and policymakers from UK academia, public and voluntary and community sectors. We will hear how they use and gain insight into discourses of representation in data focused on populations, communities and individuals. We do recognise that as the first event in this area, the UK Data Service has facilitated, we're not able to present all of the characteristics that may be missing from data. We hope the discussion that follows from the event will be just the beginning, and later on we'll share with you our invitation to join the ongoing conversations. Okay, so now I'm delighted to introduce our keynote speaker, Lemn Sissay. Lemn Sissay MBE is a BAFTA-nominated, award-winning writer, international poet, performer, playwright, artist and broadcaster. He was the first poet commissioned to write for the London Olympics and poet of the FA Cup, and he's also the Chancellor of the University of Manchester, which is one of the partners in the UK Data Service. So on to our first panellist, who's Dharmi Kapadia. Now, I started introducing her earlier, but Dharmi is a lecturer at the Department of Sociology at the University of Manchester and a member of the ESSC Centre on Dynamics of Ethnicity. She was a member of the UK Data Service's first cohort of Data Impact Fellows. She's got expertise in social statistical methods, and her main areas of research are ethnic inequalities in health and access to health services. She's also conducted research on ethnic inequalities in the labour market and on the relationships between poverty, ethnicity and social networks. So please to welcome you, Dharmi, over to you.
Thank you. And I just want to say, start by saying, wow, thanks to Lemn for such a powerful and heartbreaking keynote speech of his journey of finding out about himself, his story and his family in the face of being made invisible in data. So thank you very much for that. And thank you to the UK Data Service Impact Team for inviting me to speak here. So the past year has seen inequalities in the UK laid bare in the face of the coronavirus pandemic. Inequalities faced by those living in poverty, by women, those working in insecure jobs, and not least by ethnic minority people. I've been working on ethnic and racial inequalities in the UK for the past 8 years as a member of the Centre on Dynamics of Ethnicity, led by the University of Manchester. And at the moment, from a research and data perspective, there's a lot of interest in the inequalities faced by ethnic minority people. And this is more so than before. But when researchers come to look at the data that's available on these groups, what do they find? So the phrase that I used in my blog published by the UK DS Impact Team last week was represented yet excluded. But another phrase came to mind this morning, and Lemn's already mentioned it. This phrase comes to mind repeatedly when I think about the experiences of ethnic minority people, both how they're treated in their everyday lives and in data. And that phrase is so visible yet invisible. By this, I mean that many ethnic minority people are visibly minorities, but often their experiences to a large extent are not sufficiently acknowledged and sometimes are completely erased from our data sources. And today I'm going to talk briefly about two research projects that I work on. The first project is about inequalities faced by ethnic minority older people, and this is funded by the Nuffield Foundation. And this project was born out of the research team's interest in severe disadvantages that this group, these ethnic minority older people, face. And these disadvantages are often accumulated over the life course, leading to worse health and economic circumstances in later life. And these experiences that I'm talking about are experiences of racism, poor housing, poor job opportunities. Quite a lot of ethnic minority older people living in this country came to the UK as migrants, and they faced a lot of hardship, a lot of racism, a lot of discrimination when they arrived. So because of our research interests, we checked in a number of surveys housed by the UK Data Service and found that quite a lot of the data wasn't what we wanted. It couldn't answer our research questions. And we found that the number of people aged 65 and over was very low, so not enough to do the kind of statistical analysis that we do as quantitative researchers. So for example, there are only 36 Bangladeshi women aged over 65 in the latest wave of Understanding Society, and that's the UK's largest household longitudinal study. In the survey that looks specifically at older people, that's the English Longitudinal Study of Aging, or ELSA, there's only 500 ethnic minority people, which comprises just over 5% of the sample of the latest wave. So to address these data problems, we've pooled a number of data sets that include ethnic minority boost samples from the period from 1993 to 2017, to have enough people in each of the ethnic categories to do sound data analysis. And this is important because we want to keep different ethnic groups separate, and we oppose the use of combining ethnic groups just to provide data on an overarching BAME group, a term which I don't like, and I encourage people to use to conduct data analysis and use terms for ethnic groups distinctively. And our findings show that the inequalities in health for ethnic minority older people in this country have persisted for more than two decades up to the present day. The second research project that I'd like to talk about is the Evidence for Equality National Survey, or EVENS, that launched last week to document the experiences of ethnic and religious minority people during the COVID-19 pandemic, which is funded by the Economic and Social Research Council, ESRC. The survey is being administered by Ipsos Mori and can be completed online and on the telephone, and we're aiming to recruit 17,000 ethnic and religious minority people. And we're asking participants questions related to racism and discrimination, their health, how their job has been affected during the pandemic, how caring responsibilities have changed, and how they've been policed amongst others. And we're using non-probability sampling methods. So this is snowball sampling, convenient sampling, as you might know it. And really now these methods are becoming more the norm, especially during the pandemic for surveys where we can't go out to people's houses. And this perhaps represents the future of large-scale quantitative data collection. Indeed, the ONS expects that 75% of the 2021 census forms will be filled in online. In our survey, in EVENS, in order to ensure that we can recruit 17,000 people, we're working in partnership with large ethnic minority-led voluntary and community organisations, such as Muslim Council of Britain, Operation Black Vote, Race Equality Foundation, to really get the message out about this survey and encourage people to fill it in. And the innovation of this survey is not only its sampling design, we're also collecting ethnicity in a number of ways. So as Lem mentioned in his answer to the question that was posed by an audience member, not only are we providing a drop-down box where people can tick their ethnicity, but also including a writing box for people to self-define their ethnicity. So this is new in this kind of survey. It's also the first time in a national survey that we're going to differentiate Black African people of sub-Saharan descent and those who are not. And it's the first time that Roma and Gypsy traveller populations will be meaningfully represented in such a large national survey. So just to kind of sum up, I'd like to say that, you know, a lot of, you know, my presentation may have come across a little bit critical of the data sources that we have in this country, but really a lot of advances have been made towards including and representing ethnic and religious minority groups in surveys. We've seen that there'll be an addition of the Roma category for the 2021 census, which is the ONS and this country acknowledging that Roma people in this country do face severe disadvantages. But moving forward, we need commitment to collect data, to produce data-based evidence, to tackle inequalities. And we need this commitment from statutory organisations, as well as being a key principle for large-scale national surveys in the UK. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Dharmi. We're going to move on to the next panellist, and at the end there'll be opportunity to ask questions of all of the speakers. So if you could sort of save your questions until we've got until all the panellists have had a chance to speak. So I'd now like to introduce Daniel Staetsky. Dr. Daniel Staetsky is a senior research fellow at Jewish Policy Research and director of its European Jewish Demography Unit. His expertise spans the disciplines of demography, applied statistics and history, and he's a former researcher and analyst at the Central Bureau of Statistics in Israel and at RAND Europe. He specialises in Jewish, European and Middle Eastern demography with over 20 years of experience and a long publication record in those fields. Over to you, Daniel. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And hello, everybody. I don't have a very long presentation, obviously. The limitation is significant. I only have 5 minutes. So I would keep this exhibit in front of you at all times. And relate to it, don't try to go through it in a very detailed way right now. Just relate to it for now as a picture of a person, where you basically see two differently colored fields. And I will slowly unfold and explain what they are. It's worth saying from the start that the Institute for Jewish Policy Research, which is the body I represent today, we are, well, as it says, as it basically says, it tells you on the tin, we're a research body. We collect, not only we collect, we analyze and disseminate statistics and statistically based insights, I should call it that, about the condition of Jews in Europe and in Britain. And this is this is our core activity. We do that for the sake of Jewish communities, global Jewish community, European and British Jewish community, but we don't just work with Jewish organizations, we work with every single organization on the planet in Britain that has something to do with Jews and needs data about Jewish people. It's worth saying parenthetically that we're quite an old institution. We exist since the 40s. We were established in the United States of America, actually moved to European soil in the 60s under the conditions of Cold War. And since that time, pretty much consistently, demography and social statistics are our core activities. Now, what we do, here basically I'm moving to describe our activities with respect to inclusion and solutions around that. Our activities are, I would say, dictated by the essential condition of Jews everywhere, apart from Israel, and that Jews are a religious and ethnic minority, first of all. And secondly, it's a small minority, and that's important. So in the data, we more often than not display what I call the rarity problem. So the rarity problem is highlighted on the right. There's a box on the right that says the rarity problem. This is something that dominates our activity. In Britain, just to give you an illustration, Jews are less than 0.5% of the population. And that has implications on how we capture and surveys, if we are at all. And the second box, the second blue box is another problem, if you wish. It's an objective problem, which I could relate to it, minority status. Not in any particular political sense, but as a factual sense. Being a minority, you need to, or being part of the minority, you need to be identified in the sources. It's as simple as that. And not only we want to be identified, we need to be correctly identified. Not only that we need to be identified and correctly identified, but also counted. So all of this needs, these are conditions that need to be, in a way, fulfilled. In the middle, between these two problems highlighted or issues highlighted in blue, which is minority status and the rarity problem that is not going away, I listed in the sort of an orange box the sources which contain or should contain or may contain data on Jewish individuals and the sources we work with. And there are different degrees of, some of them include information on Jewishness, some of them don't. And some of them include it in the correct form, some of them don't include it in the correct form. All of that we're trying either to change, so to introduce or sponsor or lobby for changes in this particular data collection modes that lead to the creation of the sources in such a way that Jewish individuals could be identified in them. Or we create our own tailored solutions. So we create group-specific sources or resources which we sponsor ourselves. And I will give a few illustrations in that respect. So let me give you a few illustrations of how inclusion, what I mean by ensuring inclusion, what we actually do in that respect. Now, a lot of sources today, whether it's administrative data or census or surveys, they rely ultimately on the forms that people fill in, questionnaires that are given to people. And it's incredibly important, obviously, in order to create, to ensure inclusion of Jewish individuals or any other minority group, to simply identify that group, to create a response scheme in which people who are members of this particular minority see themselves, and they simply know how to identify themselves. And Jews in Britain, there's a tradition of identifying Jewish people by religion, and that works. It works in the context of the census. It doesn't work. It doesn't exist in the context of vital registration. So while census tells us about how many Jews are in Britain and tells us the truth, as far as we can tell, the vital registration, so statistics of births and deaths, doesn't tell us that. So that is something to be, from our point, to be changed and enhanced. Administrative data sources don't collect information on religion or collect it on insufficient quality. So even if we have this, such as NHS, for example, it makes it unusable. As for the surveys, most surveys today, I'd say most surveys collect data on religion and Jews can be identified. But we have a formidable rarity problem on the right, where being just 0.5% of the population, we can't have much hope with respect to surveys that have typical samples are 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 people. So we need to literally wait for decades to create a sufficiently robust number of Jews in the survey. So this is basically a very schematic description of our activities, as I said, ensuring inclusion in all of these sources listed in the middle and correcting the deficiencies in that respect when these occur. And secondly, solving somehow or overcoming the rarity problem, which is an objective problem that doesn't go away simply through removing non-inclusions, through ensuring inclusion still. A small minority such as Jews, not Jews, they're not by no means a single minority of that kind, need special methods if these people need are to be captured in the sources. It's either boosting or creating group-specific resources. A simple inclusion may or may not help. So far from me, this is the data dance of the Institute for Jewish Policy Research in a nutshell. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel. Thank you very much. So we'll move on to the next panellist, which is Kevin Guyan. Now, Dr. Kevin Guyan works as a researcher for Advance HE, an organisation that focuses on equality, diversity and inclusion among staff and students in UK higher education. Kevin is the author of the forthcoming book, Queer Data, Using Gender, Sex and Sexuality Data for Action, which examines the collection, analysis and use of gender, sex and sexuality data, particularly as it relates to LGBTQ people in the UK. Over to you, Kevin. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Gillian. And thank you to the UK Data Service Impact Team for the invite to speak today. So I'm going to be speaking really wearing two hats. As Julian mentioned, I work as a researcher for the higher education organisation Advance HE, but alongside that, I'm also engaged in scholarship around the collection, analysis and use of gender, sex and sexuality data, particularly as this relates to LGBTQ individuals in the UK. So as part of Advance HE's research team, we publish annual statistical reports on identity characteristics of all staff and students in UK higher education. So our most recent reports published last year, last October, cover data collected by the Higher Education Statistics Agency for the 2018-19 academic year. This was information on just under 2.4 million students and 440,000 staff. As you can see, that was a gigantic data set. And what's particularly exciting for someone engaged in equality and diversity research is that this data includes information on a range of different identity characteristics, including gender, sexual orientation, and trans status. So my presentation this morning is going to focus on the three strands, what we might consider gender, sex, and sexuality data. So as time is short, and rather than consider what data tells us about LGBTQ staff and students, I instead want to offer some provocations as to what happens at the intersection where data practices and concepts of gender, sex, and sexuality meet. For these reasons, I'm not only interested in what data says about LGBTQ individuals, but I'm really interested in what data, how it relates to power and its expression and use in terms of representation. I'm interested in how we establish, who counts, and how this brings some identities into focus while casting other identities further into the shadows. I'm also going to look at how we acknowledge the data practices are both productive and partial. And thirdly, how we might use the idea of something I label queer data competence to ensure that decisions about data are made by those who are most affected. So firstly, the broad question is something we're kind of going to tease out throughout the day, the question of who counts. So attempts to categorize and establish who counts as LGBTQ means that some people are always left behind. Those most likely to gain from efforts to tweak data practices so that they're more inclusive are individuals who are often closest to the ideal of full equality. So in my work, this is often white, middle-class, cis, gay men. One example where we've seen this play out quite recently is developments in Scotland related to the design of the sex question in the 2022 census. So the next census, taking place in 2021, next month, in Northern Ireland, England and Wales, and the following year in Scotland, will for the first time provide an opportunity for people to identify as lesbian, gay, bisexual and trans. However, the census will not meaningfully count those who identify as non-binary, who will still be required to identify their sex as either male or female. I raise this example here to show that surface level changes to data practices can actually stifle structural progress and potentially entrench inequality in ways that are sometimes harder for us to tackle. Secondly, the idea of data practices as something productive and partial. This really underscores how decisions made by data producers bring some identities into being while leaving others behind. A critical approach to data is therefore required to expose the limits of quant data, the contested decisions made during the collection analysis, and how efforts to count LGBTQ communities only ever presents one representation of the social world. And thirdly, the actions of data producers are never neutral and therefore must ask what is being precluded from view. For example, what is lost when a team of cisgender and heterosexual individuals design questions intended to capture data about LGBTQ lives? Now, it's not practical for those in decision-making spaces to always bring lived experiences to the table. We therefore need to ensure that those with power to make decisions about data which impacts the lives of LGBTQ individuals are queer data competent. So very briefly, this requires a basic knowledge of language and concepts associated with LGBTQ identities, an understanding of historical and social factors, the means that equality of opportunities of fiction, and an awareness of power differences both between and importantly within LGBTQ communities. So to bring things to an end, I've presented here some really critical provocations as to the collection and analysis of gender, sex, and sexuality data. For data producers, the design of collection tools do not arrive as some sort of ahistorical or apolitical artifact. They are crafted, tweaked, and changed to serve the particular interests of individuals, organizations, or ways of thinking. So when engaged in critical studies of data, we must deal with multitudes. We can celebrate developments while also reflecting upon what was lost along the way and ensure that we continue the fight to ensure that when data about LGBTQ individuals is collected, it's used in ways that really improves the lives and experiences of those about whom the data relates.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Kevin. On to our next speaker, who is Craig Moss. Craig is the research manager for Scope, responsible for most of the social research conducted by the organisation. Craig has worked as a social researcher for 20 years within research and policy for the third sector and has delivered a variety of research programmes with marginalised and socially excluded groups. Craig is passionate about data accessibility, research ethics and celebrating diversity and equality for all. As well as working for Scope, he's Vice Chair of the Social Care Research Ethics Committee as part of the Health Research Authority. Thank you, Craig.
Very much. One in five people in the UK identify as a disabled person. Yet for such a large proportion of the population, it's only relatively recently that disabled people have gained significant and equal rights under the Disability Discrimination Act. Despite this milestone, which is celebrated its 25th anniversary last year, disabled people continually struggle with the way society identifies them. Within the Equality Act 2010, which has now replaced the DDA, disabled people are identified and framed by a medical definition, basically to ascertain what conditions or impairments do they have and whether their condition affects their day-to-day activities for an extended period. And it is this application of this definition within the data collection and subsequent policy and research that can be a challenge for identity and the self. The definition is inherently a medical model of disability rather than the social model of disability, which when introduced revolutionised the way society's relationship to disabled people was framed and empowered disabled people to reframe how they thought about themselves. The individual rather than being the problem is disabled by societal barriers, environmental, attitudinal and institutional, restricting people's ability to live the life they choose. Furthermore, disabled people are often classed as one or larger simplified groups rather than people with individual needs and experiences to be heard. There are parallels here to other groups who also experience inequalities, such as the LGBTQ plus community or ethnic minorities communities. Where in pulling together as a unit to address inequalities, society can often perceive each group as an uncomplicated, homogenous whole with broad brush, often ill-informed assumptions about the individuals within them. Meaningful consultation is to ascertain the need within these groups is frequently neglected or under-resourced, which is particularly affecting at government and institutional levels. These institutional barriers can continue to perpetuate the way communities experience inequalities are measured, understood and represented by data, and how they are subsequently framed in policy and reports. For example, could disability, rather than being measured as a list of long-term impairments or conditions, be framed as an individual's access needs to society so that data can be utilised based on individual need and societal support structures? So next slide, please. I've decided to leave this slide because just for time, but just wanted to say the coronavirus has exposed inequalities and widening cracks sort of further. And it's just great that we have these opportunities to discuss things and debate a bit more. And these kind of conversations are starting to happen. And we'll obviously bring that up in the discussion sessions later. So I'll skip on to the next slide, please. Thank you. And here is just an example of some of the work that Scope's been doing. I'm happy to chat with anyone after the fact. And one of the things I'm going to pick on is the disability price tag work and go on to talk a little bit further about some of our co-production work we're doing. So the disability price tag research is a good example of where Scope has been able to complete some detailed analysis on using a large representative data set, including disabled people. It was an economic analysis to ascertain the estimation of extra cost of disability and equivalent cost of being a disabled person when comparing households in the UK. We used the Family Resource Survey from the ONS. And through structured equation modelling, we calculated the extra cost of disability for UK households by comparing the standard of living of those households with disabled people against those without. We created a number of indicator indexes. Our standard of living index, which is the diagram there, which I just described as a very complicated flow diagram, but basically it uses deprivation indicators that cover the areas of people's lives, such as fresh food access, furniture repair, and the ability to go on holiday. And it allowed us to create a comparable standard of life between households. It would have been useful if we could have covered areas important to disabled people as well, such as detailed information on transportation or energy use. But we married this with identity-dependent variables such as social demographics, personal details, family size, educational level, for example, and health indicators. Our findings were striking, and on average, the monthly cost of extra disability was roughly £580 for disabled people and their families. Basically, the extra cost came from three main areas: higher costs for standard services such as insurance, higher usage of standard services such as energy, and specialist equipment such as assistive tech. And we're now using some of this work to talk with government about calculations of poverty and about how to inform strategy and policy. One of the ways we've also been engaging to work with and alongside disabled people in research we produce and support identity through scope is to embrace inclusivity through co-production across the organisation. This supports embedding disabled people's direct input into the process and decision making of moving from the doing for approach to the doing with where we can, and firmly embracing the mantra, nothing about us without us, true collaboration, partnership, working. One such project is where we have recently completed, in collaboration with the iHuman Institute at the University of Sheffield, exploring social capital of disabled young people. The research was conducted by the unit's co-research collective, a group of young social researchers who are disabled people. They work with disabled young people to explore key assets and elements of their lives and document their identity and extension of self and independence through their connections with the world around them. The findings are yet to be published, but following the success of this work, Scope is now looking to establish its own research collective and co-produce research activities working alongside disabled people as researchers and key informants to address how to identify how disabled people are expressed through statistics presented on Scope's website. Statistics are commonly used to portray people experiencing inequality as disadvantaged, to solicit empathy. And we want to change this by involving disabled people in our reframing representation project to address how statistics are presented. It is our ambition that we'll be more informed about effective and engaging data collection methods, how data will be more representative, involving people with lived experience, and using the accompanying language to frame statistics which disabled people identify with, which describes them as people with their own individual lives rather than numbers, and that this is inclusive and accessible as possible. Thanks very much. And anyone really that's interested in taking part in this research project, either as a researcher or a key informant, please don't hesitate to contact me. And if you need anything described about the work further, just come back to me later, and my email is available on the final slide, which I think will be circulated. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Craig. And then on to our final speaker for today, which is Karen Hurrell. Dr. Karen Hurrell is a professional statistician who's worked for the Equality and Human Rights Commission since 2007 and previously for the Equal Opportunities Commission. She's worked on a wide range of issues over the years, for example, pay gaps, stop and search and hate crime statistics, and on all protected characteristics covered by the Equality Act 2010. She's currently collating data for the next Is Britain Fairer statutory review. Karen.
Thank you. I'm just going to say a bit about the work that the Equality and Human Rights Commission has been doing to measure progress. Thank you. So we're a statutory non-departmental public body, which was established by the Equality Act 2006. And we're a national equality body, as well as a National Human Rights Institute. And we cover Great Britain, so England, Scotland, Wales, but not Northern Ireland. And one part of the Equality Act says that we should report to Parliament at least every 5 years on Britain's progress in equality and human rights. And to do that, we are required to define a set of indicators, and those indicators have formed a measurement framework which we've created to specify the topics we will look at and the types of evidence we should look at to give us, as it says, a framework for pulling together the information for each of these reviews. So this is the structure of the framework. There's six domains: education, work, living standards, health, justice and personal security, and participation. And then, as you can see on the slide, within each domain, there's a number of indicators looking at different areas. The ones in bold are the ones we look at each time, and the ones in the lighter type are supplementary indicators, which we will select each time we do a review according to what the most important topics are at the time. And some of you may have seen our last review, which was released in 2018, and we're currently working on towards the next one, which, because of the pandemic, is likely to result in reports coming out sort of over the next couple of years. The exact timetable we're still thinking about, because obviously it takes some time for data to be released that actually covers the pandemic. Could we have the next slide, please? So within the measurement framework, for each of those domains, there's a set of measures, over 50 in all. And on the statistical side, statistics isn't the only thing we're looking at, but the statistics part of it is mainly these 50 measures. And we try and include a cross-section analysis for each year, and also look at change over time. And you'll see here, so this is the 9 protected characteristics that are covered by the equality legislation in the top left of this diagram. We also try and look at socioeconomic group, groups of people who are at high risk, such as this here, carers, the homeless, people in detention. And we try and look at different parts of the country, the geographical analysis. So that adds up to quite a significant amount of statistical analysis. Could I have the next slide, please? So this is a diagram of some of the sources that we draw on. And given that given who's organising this meeting, these are the ones that where we obtain evidence from the UK Data Service, and these are by no means all the sources we use. There's a lot of admin sources as well, but these are the main survey sources. And I was just going to say that look in particular at two of the protected characteristics, if I have the next slide. And these are two areas where we have been trying to obtain a broader range of data, because obviously things like data on sex and age are relatively easy to get hold of. But this one is looking at disability data, and the more detailed you get data you can get if you have information on impairment type as well. And you see here the very pale ones are the ones where we only have a very basic measurement of disability. The others go into more detail, although in a few cases they are very much based on questions about diseases rather than the harmonised questions that we would prefer to see asked about disability. And if I could have the last slide, please. And this is a summary of what data there are on sexual orientation. So this is this has been an area that has expanded and still expanding, with most of the surveys now asking a question, but the darker ones are those where there's a clear place to get the data from. The others, still in development and generally have to be requested. So I think the availability of data is an improving situation, but still some areas where we could have more information, and I shall finish there. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you very much to all of our speakers for really excellent, thought-provoking presentations. Okay, thanks everybody. So back to the seminar, and we're going to move now into our discussion session with the panel. We'll start with a few questions that have been asked by the audience, and then move on to some general questions we want to put to how to kind of continue this discussion going forward. So first of all, could I just ask the panel, first of all, to just give us your reflections on the discussions we've been having so far?
I was going to say, just first thing was how much alignment there is across all the different groups that we've talked about. The sort of shared experience of people in the different communities, and how it's the same issues really that are raised by everyone, to be honest. That'd be my first reflection to start the conversation.
Yeah, that was my main takeaway as well, is I think really being led by what people say, led by people's lives, people's experiences, and building our data, building our systems, our structures around that. I think sometimes we fall the trap of trying to get our lives to match what the data says it should do, or the system, or the way of doing things. And I think that real kind of community dimension about valuing what people say, I think, came out really key across everyone's talks.
Yeah, that stood out for me as well. And I think it feels quite, feels a little bit disappointing that so many marginalised communities are facing such hardship, exacerbated by the pandemic. And then as researchers and people working in organisations advocating for people who are suffering, are really having to fight to get them represented in data as well. I think that feels a little bit frustrating, because it seems as though that should really just be a given, that if we have these really marginalised communities, then of course we should direct resources towards making sure that they are appropriately represented, to ensure that we have proper data on them.
I think these things are cyclical as well. So if you don't involve people in their data, then they're not going to give you the data for you to understand more about people themselves. So it can be sort of self-fulfilling a bit, and people then get further excluded.
I think as well, one comment that we had on on the launch of our survey last week was that, well, we have lots of data that show us about these inequalities that different groups face, so for us ethnic minority people face. Why do we need more data? Why do we need more data to tell us about how badly people are doing? Why don't the people who have the power to do something about this, local governments, national governments, do something about this? And I think, when that was posed to us, I really empathised with that, and I thought, well, that is kind of how I feel as well. But the important thing is that we do need to keep pushing the message of how marginalised and how disadvantaged people are. And one of the best ways to do that is presenting people with the facts about that, and presenting people with the data about that.
Can I start with one question that's been posed, and this one from Matthew Willard. So he says, can we talk a little bit about language? So for years, survey designers have used language to describe things which are not in their competence. So, and it speaks to the kind of co-creation point that some of you are making in your talk. So white statisticians coming up with terms for ethnicity questions. how do we allow minority opinion to have a voice without being as culturally inappropriate as some language has been in the past?
I think from my point of view, you know, I said specifically I don't like the term BAME. And that is an opinion I think that is shared by other ethnic minority people and researchers working in the field of ethnicity and race, because it lumps together people who have very different and distinct experiences. And it's as though that term is essentialized, so as if BAME is a thing. BAME is not a thing, it's an acronym. And I think, you know, maybe other people would disagree, because it's a shortcut and it's a way to describe groups of people who we all think we know who we're describing by using that term. But I think wherever possible, and I think this applies to kind of any kind of marginalized community or groups, we should be being very specific about what we're talking about and who we're talking about. In this country, the experience of, for example, British Indian people is very different from the experience of Chinese people or Black African people or Gypsy and Irish traveller people, but they would all come under this category BAME. And you know, I think this term is now, you know, that's the term that's on trend at the moment. And in the past, it will have been other terms. And I think I tend to use ethnic minorities. Some people like to use minoritized groups instead to show the disadvantage that they face. So I think terminology and the language we use is very important, because it signifies what we think about these groups. It signifies the importance that you're giving to their experiences.
Mm. What do others think on that?
Daniel's got his hand up, I think. He's
gonna... Oh, sorry, yes. Daniel, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. I think I would continue the subject, the topic that Dharmi started. And I would say that indeed, BAME is a concept that's, I mean, close to meaningless. And I think people who do use it, it means something for them. Okay. And we need to ask ourselves all of these labels, what actually do they mean? Do they serve any kind of practical question, pragmatic question? Do they help in terms of policy, for example? That's the fixed star that I think we should be guided by. Now, I will share with you probably an event or that is basically unfolding. The Jewish community today and in the past 5 years, I'd say, we have been consulted about the use, about the proper ways to capture Jewish population in the census and surveys. And basically, it's a discussion, it's a debate between religion and ethnicity. Okay, how do you capture Jewish population? Is it a type of religious group? Is it a type of ethnic group? Is it maybe both? So the reality, the truth of the matter, that it's both, but that doesn't particularly matter in the administrative context. The administrative context, you really have to create a way for people so they can see themselves in the questionnaire. It may be compromised with their inner feeling, for example, but they have to be able to identify themselves in the questionnaire. And so we advocated early on that Jewish population is reflected as religion and ethnicity. Later, we changed this position slightly. We adjusted it. We could see that religion is enough. Even people who are not religious, who don't hold very strong version of faith, the Jewish people will know that religion question is there for them. So they will see themselves. So that particular emotion or that particular sentiment, you know, needed to be identified and reported. But there is a bigger question for us, and that's not a Jewish question, far from that. The reality is changing all the time. Meaningful groups are being created all the time. Equality or outcomes have to be monitored along certain lines all the time, and these are changing. So how does the statistical system adjust itself? Is it flexible enough to reflect these changes that could occur all the time? And still, can we marry the attention to the small groups often disadvantaged groups with the requirements of statistics, because sometimes you attempt to create sizable categories of people. And when you attempt to create sizable categories, you don't want to split, you want to somehow increase the size of them. So I think that for us, at least, the meaningful, very meaningful discussion is A, how we are reflected, and is the data collection flexible enough to incorporate changes, but also we need to ensure that, I mean, the situation should be such that we create statistically significant, not in any political sense, but analyzable groups with all the labels that we use. Can this be done? How this can be done? That's my, I'd say, preoccupation, support, and that opinion, I'd say, that view is supported by what I have heard here.
Thank you. Yeah, and that actually leads in nicely into a question from Sarah Metcalf, which is, how can we start to approach the improvement of data collection to ensure the amplification of diverse voices? If people we want to reach are not engaged for various reasons and we cannot obtain their data, we cannot tell their stories, how can we improve this? So I think that's kind of the million-dollar question, isn't it, in this? I'm really interested in what people think about this.
I think that's a really interesting question. I think, again, kind of continuing the thread from Daniel's answer around the census, it's really kind of come to fruition of late around sexual orientation and transgender identity questions in the upcoming censuses. And I think, how do we show people that being counted in a state data collection exercise is safe, secure, but also meaningful for their everyday lives? And I think for a lot of minoritized groups, a lot of people's relationships to data collection activities, whether it's through police, surveillance, law enforcement, is quite a negative experience. So I think, how do we ensure that when data is collected about minoritized groups, whether it's gender, sexual minorities or racial groups, religious groups, that actually that data is being used to improve people's everyday lives? And I think that's really the key nub of how do we get people on board about participation and being engaged, is actually ensuring that we're not collecting data for data's sake, but we're actually using it in ways that has material everyday impacts.
And I think also sort of marginalized groups, they are stigmatized. So, and that drives, those groups also experience extra levels of other issues, for example, domestic violence. One in 20 people in the UK, I think, that suffered domestic violence, but it's something like one in seven for disabled people. So those experiences push people further away from being able to engage with data collection, and this, it makes it much more a complicated story. And I think that's why I believe co-production is a really important way of approaching that, to engage with the community, and also to sort of, I don't know, it sort of shakes the box a little bit, co-production. You hand the reins over to other people and the communities themselves, and that's quite a scary and liberating thing at the same time, being a research manager and trying to have a program of research that we deliver, for example. We're trying to steer that, but also let that be as free as possible. And that's why I think co-production is quite a powerful thing, which I mentioned obviously in my talk.
Yeah, I think as well, I kind of really agree with what Kevin was saying about people feeling excluded from research because there's such a lack of trust in state institutions, which have been the site of discrimination. So if the people that are asking you to fill in a survey are the people that have treated you very badly in the past, well, you think they are the people that treated badly in the past, why would you want to hand over very personal information to them? And I think this is one of the reasons why some people don't want to take part in data collection initiatives, and they don't see the importance of them sometimes because they have participated before and nothing's actually changed. So I think there is disillusionment within people, but that is up to data providers, data collectors and state agencies to fix. This is not about encouraging people on an individual level to take part. And just to add to what Craig said about co-production, we have to remember when we're talking about data, we're talking about all forms of data, not just quantitative data. That is not the most important form of data. So I'm a mixed methods researcher, but I'm trained as a quantitative analyst. But I don't believe that quantitative data holds all the answers. So using co-produced qualitative data to add richness, to add nuance to the quantitative data we have is imperative. And we do need a shift in the thinking of what counts as data, what counts as important data. And people's lived experiences and those stories should form part of that important resource that we have.
Okay, thank you very much for that. So we're going to capture all of the Q&As that have been put and ask people to respond separately. But now I'd just like to move on to the issue of really looking at what do you think is the key development that would support the continued and evolving representation of self and identity in data? So to our panellists, you know, what can we really do to make, you know, make changes here?
I think it's embrace the communities as experts themselves. Empowering communities to conduct research as well. That's been very self-rewarding for the people involved and has expanded the research that I've been working on with people. It's been quite a reciprocal relationship, and that builds trust, and people are able then to sort of go into the communities and think about in creative ways to engage people. And I think that trust is a really important thing, especially when elements like benefits are affected or people's statuses in the UK, for example, are affected, and how society responds to them.
I think I can kind of add to that as well, thinking about, I guess, again, what happens at space between data practices and identity. And I think as data moves more and more, has more and more interest in work around identity characteristics, I think we do need to really acknowledge that people, for a variety of reasons, will not want to share data about their identity. I think we need to build systems and structures that fully acknowledge and recognize that space for refusal, that space for not participating in these systems. And I think there's a lot of particularly fantastic work taking place in the US among data justice campaign groups, particularly around the issue of data on Black people in America. And again, how do we build systems and structures that acknowledge people's refusal and acknowledge people's informed decision not to participate in data collection exercises? I think we often have an assumption that everyone will give data if we can just push them hard enough. Actually, I think we need to turn that issue slightly and think, how do we really acknowledge people's refusal in meaningful ways as well? And I think that's kind of lacking at the moment.
Okay, and actually one question I think that we should come back to, and it relates to this, you know, the small size of some groups. So how do we address the situations where marginalized groups make up such a small proportion of the available data that the data controllers won't let researchers see the data because it might be disclosive and things like won't have to be linked with other data, or it's classed as statistically insignificant? How do we make sure that we involve the groups whilst also protecting their privacy?
I think when it's administrative data or census data, and that is the actual number of people looking at it on a local level, then there's not much you can do about that. That is a statistical disclosure control issue, and you can't access data that will put people at risk. But obviously, if you were looking at things on a country level, there probably wouldn't be such small groups that you can't access the data, but it might be the case for some groups. But when we're talking about data that's collected in national surveys, we need to go back to the beginning when we're thinking about the design of the survey and think about oversampling groups, that we need to make sure we've got a big enough sample to do proper analysis. So as I mentioned in my talk, I use surveys that use ethnic minority boost sampling to try and make sure that there's enough ethnic minority groups. Understanding Society tries to aim for 1,000 people in each of the large ethnic minority groups. That's Black African, Black Caribbean, Pakistani, Bangladeshi and Indian, so that when researchers are looking at the data, you can do some subgroup analysis. Obviously, that gets harder if you want to try and do it by geography. So, for example, at, you know, MSOA level, like the super output layer. So things do get difficult, but it is, I think, for surveys and smaller data collection initiatives, you need to think about this at the design level. And obviously for some admin data, I don't think that's an issue that can be solved.
I just add a very quick point to that as well. I think the bulk of work I see, actually, people often use small numbers as an excuse not to do things. And actually, when we jump into the data, whether it be quant or qual, there's often enough to work with. And I sometimes feel that meaningful concerns around small numbers often stops work before it even begins. And I think that's what I tend to come across more so, particularly in the higher education sector with quite large samples, than the issue of overly small numbers.
Okay, then one kind of overarching question. So how would you see intersectionality in supporting identity in data? And could we go around the panel and ask you all to comment on that? So maybe Craig, you're top left of my screen, so can I begin with you? Thank you.
Can you just repeat it? Sorry, I didn't quite hear you.
How would you see intersectionality could support identity in data?
Well, one of the things that has jumped out at me is, as I said at the start, the issues sort of cross over the different groups that we're sort of talking about here. And I wondered if there could be a way, there would be a standard approach where all of these groups are kind of captured as standard within any survey that someone might do. And that's obviously tricky because it's hard enough to get that data collection anyway for the groups. So, but I wonder if there's a way that could be done, so then any kind of piece of research that was being conducted could be analysed from the different points of view of the different communities involved.
Thank you, that's a good point. Daniel, could you comment?
Yeah, I think the greatest lesson, really, from my, I don't know, 11 maybe years of involvement in the minority research, let's call it that, in Britain, was that, first of all, there's a tremendous, very obvious for me, need to ensure that the major administrative sources at the level of, for example, organizations like NHS, they include the relevant variables that describe the diversity in Britain. So they either don't include them, or they include them, but actually data are not collected. It's left to the discretion of the respondents. For example, if you register with a new practice, there is an ethnicity question in the questionnaire, and it's made clear to you that you don't have to fill it in. Now, so there has to be some sort of shared position on what's, I mean, if we are serious about collecting the data, how do we go about it? Because most people don't fill it in, or a lot of people wouldn't fill it in, not because they object, they don't want to be identified, but they don't particularly enjoy filling in the questionnaire. As simple as that. However, to capture ethnicity, to capture religion, that needs to be done. It needs to be done in NHS, perhaps other data, administrative data sets. It's an imperative to include these variables in the deaths and birth certificate in these systems.
Yeah. So already, sorry, I have to. We're running short of time. Actually, thank you, Daniel.
So that is basically my.
Thank you. No. Sorry to cut you short. Karen, I wonder if you could comment on that, because from your perspective.
Yes, I mean, intersectionality, I mean, I didn't mention this during the presentation earlier, but that's an important part of our analysis. We try and look at combinations of protected characteristics and not just each of them separately, because you really don't get a sufficient picture of what's going on if you just look at age separate from disability, separate from sex and all the other characteristics. But again, of course, there are limitations then. From sample size, as we've mentioned before, if you're going to divide up a population into very many different groups, then it can make it more difficult to get good, robust results.
Yeah, thank you. Kevin, Dharmi, sorry, I have to say, could you say perhaps 30 seconds each on the intersectionality point?
Yeah, I'll try and say something very quick. I think it goes back to the point I said about looking within groups. So I think if we treat the LGBTQ community as a monolith, actually what that does is bring to the fore those who are already most privileged, so often white gay men, and it leaves some of the people who are maybe experiencing multiple kind of intersections of disadvantage, often cast them further into shadows. So I think it really needs to be baked in, into all the work we do to ensure that when we do work, it's not just kind of going for the people who are the least minoritized within minoritized groups.
Okay.
Yeah, and I think this is an issue that we thought about when we were designing the Even survey, because we wanted to make sure that, you know, obviously our interest is in ethnic inequalities, but we want to make sure that we're collecting lots of different characteristics as well. So on socioeconomic status, sexuality, some questions on living. So some people live in, you know, for example, the Roma and Gypsy travel community live in different types of accommodation. So we made different questions which we would ensure we would capture their experiences. But I think what tends to happen in these kinds of surveys, and when we're doing individual work on our different research areas, is we're limited in space. We have limited space. We want to capture the variables that we're most interested in to do our research. And I think this is where statutory organisations have a larger role to play, to make sure the data that everybody needs is collected in more detail, rather than leaving it to different smaller surveys that, you know, which are great, but at the end of the day, we all have limited resources.
Thank you so much. I'm really sorry, really interesting discussion, but I'm going to have to draw this to a close. I do want to say, so the UK Data Service is going to be setting up an open community, so that there will be opportunities to continue the engagement and continue the discussion. There'll be information on the last of the disk mail address and information on that in the final slide and going into the chat. So do sign up to that if you're interested in continuing the discussion. So it just leaves me really to really thank all our speakers today. So thank you very much to Lemn Sissay, to Kevin Guyan, Dharmi Kapadia, Karen Hurrell, Craig Moss, and Daniel Staetsky. Thank you so much. Really, really great, interesting presentations and a great discussion. Special thanks also to Dr. Victoria Moody, who's Deputy Director and Co-I of the UK Data Service, who devised the concept of this event. And also thank you to Neil Diamond Green, who's been doing a lot of the admin and bringing the speakers together, and other technical support from the UK Data Service for running all the technology today. So thank you so much for that. So thank you. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. Hope you'll join in continuing the conversations that have started today. And there's the JISC mail details for you. Thank you.